So, let us now come to lecture 7, deep and normal models. That is also lecture 7 in the course Models and Sciences and chapter 7 in our consideration of models and modeling in computer science, where we consider models, activities to model, and modeling as MMM framework. Last lecture we considered elements of models. Elements of models are typically basic elements, complex elements, maybe are parameters, so we are using a parameter space. For specification we use something like a WH specification, and for instance for parameters we can use some kind of synergetic theory of some systematic approaches. We can use also components, it means abstract parameters. We have been starting with a consideration of the informative models, and then we applied it to different kinds of modeling approaches, and especially used generic models as a very convenient way how to construct a model from what we have been already abstracting out of our experience. In this case, we could somehow define the demarcation or give a solution for the demarcation problem. Now we have to ask ourselves, do we have to develop a model all the time from scratch? Or can we maybe inherit experience, use some canonic forms, use the background, the context, and the invariance? We have covered a number of topics already. Models are used everywhere. They have had a number of case studies. These are used as our main examples. We have used a number of notions of models, and we found finally a notion of model that we are using in this course. We considered the problem of language-based models. Languages are great enablers, but also hinderers. And last lecture we gave some insight into elements of models. This lecture will be now on deep and normal models. The background of models is typically taken for granted. The modeling mold is also typically taken for granted, especially in our community of practice. And the normal model is only what should be added to this background, this modeling mold, to the experience we have gained so far already. That means in this case we have some kind of injection of whatever we have been learning. That should be now considered in a more systematical way. We first start with Leninness and biases. Next we go with deep modeling as an economic principle, with origins of normal models, with the model background, and finally with a matrix of a model. Yeah, models are used everywhere, anytime. We use them in a shallow form or maybe in a profound form that is very nicely investigatable. We use intrinsic assumptions, conscious, subconscious, preconscious elements that should somehow to be taken into explicit consideration, or at least explicitly accepted as the groundings, as the basis, as the background of our model. For this reason, maybe we should look first into this part again from the introductory part. We have a number of models we are using in a social setting. You use this three apes example. You use maybe the nice fall results, let's say for fruits and vegetables. Or you use maybe the Wacken lady to explain how nice Wacken as an event could be. Or you use some other events, or you use figures like you see on the side of a street, like St. Bernardus. Or you use some kind of pictures and you can have an interpretation of those without being directly somehow directed to this interpretation. Some of the interpretations are a little bit more considerable. Look, for instance, for demographic models. Demographic models are often said have to form somehow a distribution in the form of a pyramid. Why we have to use a pyramid? That is because of we consider societies with high mortality. Is it true now for our society? Maybe not. Or you use the nutrition pyramid that has a very nice history. It is mainly based on some kind of investigations, somehow as a third-party project from the margarine industry, based on a number of fat theories and heavily industry-based or biased. That in this case we should maybe understand it before accepting it. That means in this case we have mental and perception models. They are lying behind. Mental models, of course, are our personal structures, maybe in an implicit form or an explicit form, our processes in an implicit or explicit form. They can be enhanced to conceptual structures with conceptions that we have learned, especially concepts or theoretical statements, models and theories and tools behind. The same is true for conceptual processes. You might use paradigms that are somehow founded, corroborated. A model, of course, is used for any kind of collaboration. That means it supports interaction, understanding, sharing, collaboration among people. Of course, it depends which community you are targeting. That means it depends on the existing knowledge, the actual state of the reality, or how you consider the state of reality, the condition of the person's senses and the state of mind, and also the state of employed instruments. That means we are using it somehow behind without being explicitly aware of that. Okay, that means in this case we are using something behind that allows us to be a little bit better oriented on what we really have to represent. And that means in this case we have some efficiency principle. The efficiency principle says inherit whatever has already been successfully used. So it leads us directly to leadenness of modeling. Modeling leadenness is based on at least five different dimensions of leadenness. One is background leadenness. These are the undisputable elements that are typically going to the grounding, like paradigms, postulates, restrictions, theories, culture, foundations, common sense, or also the disputable ones. So it's mainly going to the basis, concepts, foundations, languages, assumptions, thought communities, thought style, conventions, practices, etc. The second leadenness comes from the conceptions we are using, or the concepts we are using. These are the basic elements, and they are nicely used for incremental construction. They are also somehow biased by the concepts that have been commonly accepted by our community of practice. The third leadenness comes from the context we are using. That is, in our case, in sciences at least, the disciplinary context. It could be also the application domain context. It allows us to focus, to scope whatever we want to represent. And of course, it is also time and space dependent. The fourth leadenness comes from the community. The community of practice, the school of thought, and of course, the commonly accepted practices, conventions, ontologies, and assumptions we are using in our community. The fifth one comes from development and utilization. Because of development leads us directly to a specific point of view, how somebody or a community or a team was considering the part of reality that is represented somehow. And for this reason, we are dependent on that. That means we have now to accept whatever has been developed. The 5 kinds of readiness have been very nicely investigated in the keynote speech given by Hannu Kangasalo in EGC 2016 on the basis of the EGC 2015 keynote. Unfortunately, there is no paper yet available at the moment from him. You can imagine also the readiness, let's say, with the main four dimensions. You have an interest readiness, you have a background readiness, you have a development process readiness, and you have a pragmatics readiness. You can also somehow visualize how important this readiness is. Typically, we can say, okay, fine, some parts are relevant, other parts are not relevant. Some things are observed, we only represent whatever we are observing in reality. Some things are not observed. This can be also due to the biases which we have been using. And then you say, okay, fine, then I have to model, let's say, this little black circle. The typical thing is, what is observed and relevant, you can somehow specify. What is relevant and not observed is a problem of representation, of proper representation, and sometimes you have also some kind of real importance, what is not at all represented in our model. Okay, then we come now to the deep model. That is the intrinsic and core part of models, and it is the essential part of economic modeling. The deep model is used for sorts, for development, for maybe brownfield development instead of greenfield development, and of course for utilization economy as well. Okay, that means in this case we have to know what is the deep model, or what is, let's say, the content of the deep model. And for this reason we have to find a definition. That is really difficult to say. We would say the deep model consists at least of three parts. Of the grounding that is completely accepted without any disputes, without any discussions. For instance, the paradigms, the postulates, the restrictions, the theories, the cultures, the foundations, the conventions, the authorities, whatever is accepted. From the basis, we accept only maybe a certain extent. That means some assumptions, some concept spaces, some practices, some, let's say, selection of the language. Maybe we are somehow biased by our thought community and the thought style. We have some methodologies, we have pattern, we have routines, we have common sense. And the third part is are the outer directives that comes from the context and the community of practice. We might have to add also the dependence on the modes and the experience gained, let's say, somehow in our applications. Furthermore, we have to consider what kind of origins we are considering as the most important, as the most representative origins. That means in this case, our direction, which selection we are doing, is also specified by our deep model behind. So the deep model can be somehow layered. Deep modeling in the first step would be setting the definitional frame with some priming, with the language and actor setting. Of course, you say, okay, fine, what are the undisputable decisions? That means the grounding. What is the concept space and the context? Which actors act in which role, in which play, fulfilling which task? Of course, they are somehow already biased, but somehow accepted. The second macro step would be the choice of the model stereotype. That consists of course of the definitional frame, but adds the agenda setting and the initialization pattern. The agenda setting restricts potential utilization scenarios of models. It is thus a result of a clarification of model functions, and thus also based on the purpose and the goal of the model. The initialization may be based on generic models, or at least on the modeling experience we have gained so far, for instance, on the basis of reference models. And the third macro step is now the model development and deployment as a classical macro step. and is of course widely investigated and researched in many books. The first two steps, however, are equally important in order to know what kind of biases we have to accept. That means in this case we are making a number of decisions. We are somehow oriented by the relevance cutout, extract of components we take into consideration, we want to represent, by the level of detail, which criteria are used for selection, which components are intentionally not considered, what cannot be considered for which reason in the given context, on the idealization, on the kind of analogy we are using, on the quality characteristics and evaluation. Also, maybe decisions on the elements of the models, maybe we are using even weights to say what is important, what is truncated, what is abstracted, what is given in an abstract form, what kind of function or scenario we are taking into consideration, what is, let's say, the change we want to have, the distortion, what kind of concentration we take in an amplification. We can also assume, for instance, the semantics, or maybe the extensions of the automatic semantics, like in antimemes. We have also some kind of dominant interpretation and explanation pattern together with the semantics. Think, for instance, in entity relationship modeling, we are often assuming that this is now a set semantical framework. That must not be a set semantical framework. It could be also a multi-set. It could be also some kind of list semantics. So that the entity relationship model is accommodating XML modeling. Okay, another decision is, what are the interests within a community of practice that works as a social system? What is really the added value to this community of practice? We can also use Chomsky's alpha and beta part. We have maybe alpha developers called leaders, and we have somehow followers. Which intention has which member of the community of practice? What is a systematic and systemic orientation? The general orientation established in the modeling process, the grounding and the basis, the representation forms and maybe the complementary models, the role of a model within a model suite, or how we handle context, what kind of replenishment we are using, what kind of supplement and complement is used, and what are the alternative models. Okay, the deep model setting goes back to the philosophy of science. The earliest source I know so far is Heraclit. We have the Socratic school, maybe with followers like Aristoteles, or with Platon and Socrates. Currently, most people think that this goes back to Kuhn. Thomas Kuhn has, however, been heavily reusing, by the way, without citing properly, the work of Ludwig Fleck. The deep model in this setting combines the unchangeable part of a model. That is determined by the grounding, by the outer directives, and the basis, as we have been already introducing. That means it considers those parts that we don't want to change. The normal model can change, inject specific concepts, specific understandings in a specific, let's say, cultural setting, in a specific society setting, but the deep model is anyway underpinning the normal model that is based on the deep model. That can be in this case visualized by an iceberg. I have been using here the cultural iceberg. Modeling is mainly consisting of modeling of the normal model, that means of the upper part of the iceberg. The lower part of the iceberg is, however, not really considered. And now we say, okay, fine, our deep model now is this part of the iceberg, and we use additionally some kind of disciplinary matrix that consists of the deep model and the modeling mode. But this will be only at the end of this lecture. Deep models are often expressed through axioms. Axioms as the essential beginnings. Citing Luhmann, we can understand it in a bit better way. If we want to distinguish A from B, we must have already a notion how to distinguish A from B. Therefore, we must have a notion of the notion. Any start is therefore not justifiable and high-handed. There is no establishment and verification at the beginning. That means we start with somehow things we have to accept. So let's go directly down to the deep model. And for this reason, we say, fine, this is given, don't discuss it anymore. The same is also true for axioms and rules in first-order particle logic. Maybe we can go also further, even to non-monotonic calculi, where any element that is added may revise at least the conclusions we are making. Or you say postulates can be considered as axioms. In this case, postulates are somehow propositions that are accepted as true or in order to provide a basis for the logical reasoning. It is something assumed without proof as being self-evident or generally accepted, especially when used as a basis for an argument. It is being distinguished from axioms as being relevant to a particular science or context. This is not a general axiom, like we are using in logic's axioms. It is not a general rule, how we are using rules in logic's. It is maybe following from other axioms, but it is representing our, let's say, our thoughts, what are the beginning, what is not disputable at all. The reasoning system is also a part of the deep model stuff. Because of the reasoning system determines what can be directly derived, what can be directly assumed to be given whenever we have a number of statements. Turning it back to our six dimensions, to the hexagon, we have, of course, the society setting. We have, of course, the story space and the change. That means in this case, we have the mold and the methodology. We have, of course, also our techniques. So we have the computations and algorithms. We have, of course, our context, for instance, science, knowledge, and something else. And we have, of course, the origins we are considering as representative origins. That means we have a state space. And the model is now nothing else as an instrument. That means in this case, our deep model determines parts of this hexagon already in a proper form so that we then don't have to come back to these decisions. That is some kind of economy. This leads us directly back to what has been said in philosophy of science. We have the scientific method as Popper's research cycle, identify a problem, develop hypothesis, devise a study, analyze and evaluate, modify and repeat the process previously, and develop a theory. That is some kind of, let's say, method as a cycle you can represent here. Kuhn added to this cycle also the revision. That means in this case we have maybe a pre-science, then we have a normal science that works properly at least until a certain extent, and then we have a revolutionary science where we change our way of thinking, our school of thought, and we develop a new grounding and a new basis. This is also maybe done in our software engineering processes or in system improvement processes. We have the classical Kuhn cycle, starting with a normal science, going to a model, let's say, drift, to a model crisis, then to a model revolution, to paradigm change. The model drift means, in this case, that we have to change our approach and do it step by step. to a certain extent, we can do it, and then we have a crisis. And then we should work for a revolution, and then we start with changing our paradigms. We can add here, in this case, for systems improvements is nothing else as you have some kind of system behavior that is not really any more repairable. Then you go with a problem definition, with a system understanding, with a solution convergence, and with a realization or implementation of your solution, so that you have now a paradigm change in the system itself. That means in this case we are building somehow new systems based on this kind of revision as we do in philosophy of science. In the forthcoming chapter, I will give you a stereotype form. The stereotypes are essentially 10 different facets of specification of a model that can be directly given as initial point. First, you have the kind of model, determined by the application domain, by the scenarios, by the directives. Second, you have scenarios, instruments, and functions. Third, you have the carrier, for instance, a language, but in this case you inherit some obstinacy of languages. Fourth, you have origins considered to be representative, and for this reason, serving for development and well understanding in any kind of utilization scenario. Next, you have the context and the community of practice. You have compliances, as we considered in the last lecture. You have the mold, we should come back to it again. For modeling methods, for methodologies, for refinements, for functionalizations and strategies. Aids, you have inherited and related goods, such as reference models or generic models or any kind of other models you are using. Then you have the aspects to be considered. Then you have maybe the consequences of using this instrument. That means in this case whether the function is really somehow performed in a proper way. And then you can have some statements about the added value. That means in this case we add to the normal model its underpinning. Maybe also additionally the cargo in order to somehow to have an informative model of the given model. Okay, so in this case it means that normal models are the main product of a modeling process. The deep underpinning is however given by deep models that are accepted and taken for granted. What means it in this case for our entity relationship modeling? Okay, then we say okay, fine. We say modeling is mainly based on some kind of matrix. We'll come to the notion of matrix in a minute. To be correct for our normal models. Let's say for a communication and negotiation setting for our extended entity relationship database structure modeling, we need to specify the database structure, the viewpoints, the perspectives, and maybe some kind of perception models are used as origins. And communication scenario means in this case we have to have proper notions, proper terms to communicate in our communities. That means in this case we are using a namespace and we define some kind of adequacy and dependability mainly for our normal model and accept adequacy and dependability given in the deep model. Okay. Then in this case we have some kind of negotiation or maybe communication process to communicate what has been developed so far mainly on the basis of the normal model. That means normal modeling involves showing how systems and their models can be fitted into elements that are provided, especially by the matrix by our decisions. That means in this case by our deep model and by our mold. That means in this case normal modeling is somehow detail oriented. We can do it for the same in the same way, let's say for the normalization, for conceptual modeling. That means in this case we are at concept from concept spaces. We can do it in the same way for description and prescription. Description is nothing else as we are describing what has been given in our perception and domain situation models, allow somehow neglection of what is anyways underpinning, and then we say, okay, fine, we have maybe understood the underpinning, or maybe we have implicitly accepted this underpinning, and then we use this for the conceptual model within an entity relationship setting. We can say the same for prescriptive modeling. That means in this case we are using the model as a database structure specification with a collection of views and something what we need for system operating, and then we have our deep model somehow given in such a form that we can use it within this setting. For this reason we can say, okay, fine, modeling is normally is in reality mostly normal modeling, because if we are accepting the deep model as the underpinning. And with this automation we come now also back to another issue. We have been introducing 1001 different model notions in computer science. Steinmüller says a model is information on something, content meaning, created by someone, that is a sender, for somebody, that is a receiver, for some purpose, usage context. In this case, Steinmüller nothing else said. A normal model represents our origins in a proper form, of course, according to our community of practice, and of course, within the functions we have in mind for our models. It means in this case, it's nothing else as a characterization of normal modeling. Bernd Mahr says, a model is always at the same time a model of something and a model for something. That is true especially for the construction process. Its function is to carry some cargo from its matrix to its applicate. That is really a little bit deeper. He says that, okay, fine, the deep model is now somehow incorporated and we use this deep model somehow. Florian Mattes and Joachim Schmidt said a relational database model on the basis of the approach by COT describes semantics of declaration statements within a database specification language and thus corresponds to an abstract model of a programming language with its static and dynamic semantics, which can be specified through formal type and evaluation rules. In this case, again, we have a relational database model describes the normal model. That means the declaration statements was in some kind of application setting, and the rest is given by the deep model. Sometimes we consider also the deep model as a hidden matrix. For instance, Becker and Schütte say a model is a simplified reproduction of a planned or a real existing system. Okay, fine, that is our scenario, our function, with its process on the basis of a notational and concrete concept space that is somehow injected, that comes from the deep model. According to the represented purpose governed relevant properties, it deviates from its origins only due to the tolerance frame for the purpose. In this case, it's somehow a mix. I was putting again Bernd Mahr with his saying. You can also put the saying by Joachim Schmidt and Florian Mattes, or maybe you can use Wenzel's. A model is a simplified reproduction of a planned or real existing system with its process on the basis of a notational and concrete concept space. And he say, and Wenzel again repeats what Becker should have been saying. Okay, then we come now to the issue of how to construct a model. I claim that a model is a combination of a normal model and a core or intrinsic deep model as the model's core. And the combination is somehow very specific, depends, and it depends on the modeling domain, on the modeling approaches, on the mode. The combination can be done in a very different form. We say, okay, fine, we accept the deep model as an underpinning and detail it for the normal model. We can also somehow mix the deep model and the normal model by some kind of shuffling procedures, so that we have a construction algebra to use. We can also use the deep model as a deep first level model at the lower level of meta notations, and then say, okay, fine, normal model is nothing else as a surface model based on this deep first level model. And this, in this case, we have a second order construction framework. You can also hide the deep model and say, okay, fine, it's a brick in a component construction framework, and it follows our architecture. This is also done in our entity relationship modeling. There we say, okay, fine, an entity type is dot 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 dot, and for this reason, we can use the entity type only in this way. You can also use some kind of meta constructors, such as the ETL, extract, transform, load. And in this case, you can extract from the deep model, transform what has been extracted, and load it into the normal model. Model construction can also be based on algebras for truncation, abstract level selection, and focusing. Or you directly develop it as a model suite with a deep model and with a normal model and say, okay, fine, how they are somehow associated. I think the seven construction ways are not complete. We might have 9, 10, 20, but I think these are the main which have been observed, at least for our case study. To play with now with the deep model is nothing else as we play with this kind of cube. You have, of course, the model as an instrument. The model has represents various aspects. You might have a model that is adequate and dependable, and now you can open the cube, and what you see is now the deep model. It is behind and not visible all for the normal model. I think this kind of visualization maybe gives us a little kind of, let's say, impression how the deep model and the normal model are related to each other. Okay, let's now go back again to our hexagon. In this hexagon, we have been the community of practice, the context, the methodology and molds, and origins and the tools and the techniques. So in this case, for the deep model, we have the context, the community of practice, the methodology and mold, and the techniques that strike through. For the normal model, we accept all this what strikes through, and we have only the initials, that means our origins to be considered as representative ones. And we have, of course, then the final model. So it means in this case, we typically take anything else what is in the deep model for granted and consider only the origins that should be somehow represented in a proper form by a normal model. If we take now our model properties, let's say a model should be well-formed, should be analog, should be somehow focused, it should be purposeful, it should be justified, it should have a sufficient quality, maybe it should be effective in scenarios, we should have development methods and utilization methods, then you see here how far we go with our deep and normal model a little bit in a pictorial form. The normal model is, of course, for well-formedness very important. The deep model has its contribution. For analogy, of course, a classical, let's say, deep model has only a certain impact. It has a far higher impact for focusing and a much far higher impact for the functioning, for the purposefulness of our model. Dependability typically comes from the deep model and from the origins to a certain extent. Quality, again, is mainly from the deep model. Effectivity methods are often only related to the deep model. Okay, let's now go to the matrix. That means the matrix that contains of the deep model and the mold. This is some kind of efficiency principle. The modeling matrix consists of the deep model and the modeling scenarios. That means the agent R is derived from the modeling scenario and the utilization scenario. And in this case, we have paradigms in the matrix, an application-oriented and theoretical systematic arrangement, and a generally accepted or believed perspective of a scientific school or particular disciplines at a given moment of time, within which theories, laws, and generalization experiments are performed in support. R is called the paradigm in the matrix. It is thus a part of a general and cognitive or conceptual framework containing all the basic assumptions that are commonly accepted in our community of practice. Okay, then we can now go back again to the philosophy of science. Kuhn has been highlighting that we have some kind of symbolic generalizations as formal and readily formalizable parts or laws or some law schematas. We have to incorporate some beliefs, heuristic, ontological ones. We are interested in representing values. And additionally, we can now define, we take some kind of representative origins. So that has to be now added. How we are selecting the representative origins for our normal model. And of course, in the mathematical setting, we know it, you have to add a guiding question. That means in this case, a guide that is derived from the function of the model as an instrument in a scenario. And additionally, you have to add techniques as the methods and developer uses to pursue the members of the community of practice to his point of view. That means in this case, we have now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 parts of the disciplinary matrix. We can directly specify this way. This goes towards the postscript of the 1970 edition of The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, written by Thomas Kuhn. With our three additions we have to make for our disciplinary matrix in modeling. That means in this case, the modeling matrix as a specific disciplinary matrix consists of the deep model and the modeling scenarios with specific stereotypes and governs the rest. The agent R is derived from the modeling scenario and the utilization scenarios. This provides us all an understanding and a specific compliance framework for adequacy and dependability. So, in this case, we might consider specific molds. Let me consider one mold that was mentioned already several times in the previous lectures. That is inverse modeling. Inverse modeling is widely used as modeling from a general, let's say, model. There we specialize, according to our situation, this general model to a more specific one that represents the current situation in a better form. We have for inverse modeling a number of synonyms, that is inductive learning, sometimes also called data mining or data analysis, or machine learning, generic modeling. A very nice notion is the universal application modeling, or systematic modeling, or pattern-based reasoning. Universal applications started with a very nice observation. Some applications repeat all the time what has been already developed for other applications, let's say in a previous project. Then you can say, okay, fine, let us generalize what we have been doing so far towards a universal model. And this universal model can be now used, since we know how we derived this universal model from these more specific ones to generate again more specific ones. That means you have a number of parameters that can be used as for adaptation to this more general model to the more specific models. This can be also enhanced by Solomonov approaches for economy of adaptation and for proper reasoning, what is the most appropriate, let's say, specification or specialization of the general model. Then in this case, we start now with an application domain and problems and users. That means this is our classical setting in our hexagon. We have the context. We have maybe our mold, maybe in this case, for instance, hypothetical reasoning, what we do in sciences. And then we have some initial models, our origins, and then we have techniques, and finally we are basing our reasoning on a data space, on metadata, on observations, and then we consider mainly problem-solving concerns and deriving model. That means in this case we have a very specific approach to this kind of modeling. The entity relational modeling matrix has been already investigated in our setting, in our discussion on the, in the case study on entity relationship modeling. We have a number of assumptions that are somehow taken for granted. Origins are analogous. Maybe even we have a structural analogy. That is really a great thing. We reduce origin to a certain extent only to those things that are useful. And we use it maybe for development of systems or for communication with the business user. We have some kind of justification procedure that is based on the situation models we are representing or the domain situation models. We have some sufficiency that is restricting our quality characteristics to a very small set. And of course, we have some restrictions based on cognition, on representability, and how we consider viewpoints in our general architecture, let's say in our global S design architecture. That means in this case we have some kind of canonical stereotype for entity relationship modeling and also for enhanced entity relationship modeling. We have to complete the definitional frame. We have to say what kind of model utilization scenario we consider, what kind of functions. We specify the setting of the agenda. Then we can start with an initial modeling setting. And finally, we have maybe some kind of generic normal model with a completed matrix. Typical stereotype of modeling is the collection stereotype. We start with an ensemble of potentially model components, maybe taken from reference models or from any kind of ensembles. I took your astrophysics examples in a tool-backed maybe form with specific deep models. Then we select aspects that are relevant. We accept some kind of distortion, idealization, amplification, and then we compose the structure of the normal model. In our mind, however, we had already the deep model behind. If we come to the conceptualization principle, it is again a part of some kind of matrix. We add conception space or conception spaces or conception or concept spaces to our model, and then we come back with a very specific modeling mold that we already considered in chapter 6. I will come back in the final slide to this plan again. So in this case we are using a number of reasoning frames. We can use induction, deduction. Induction is nothing else as we go from origin to origin to origin and try to have a best possible consideration of the set of origins considered so far. That goes back to Aristoteles and to other kinds of reasoning systems. Deduction is now going the opposite way. We can now derive some kind of conclusions and use these conclusions. It is based on phenomenology, Heidegger's work or Husserl's work is here very important. And of course, we use also some kind of empirism, maybe taking us back to Newton. We can also use abductions. It means we use our reasoning framework for reasoning about the causes of some observations. That goes back to Plato, to Kant, or maybe also to Einstein, especially in the case of verification. Okay, then we have some kind of modeling, model-based reasoning now as a benefit of our method. This is okay, fine. In this case, we can reason on the model itself, and then we can believe that the conclusions we have been making based on our model are correct. That means we consider the background as given and the background as acceptable for any kind of origins which we could consider. In this case, we might be restricted by the limitations and the obstinacy of models. We use some kind of calculi for reasoning. And of course, all this depends on the scenario. So that means in this case, we are often using model suites. And of course, we have some kind of revisable modeling approach. That means also that we have some kind of revising reasoning to consider. Okay, that means in this case we have at least a big benefit of our approach. So now we have models, deep models, normal models, stereotypes, and matrices. A model is well defined, well structured, well formed with its properties. Deep models combine the unchangeable part, the outer directives as a basis, and for this reason form our grounding of modeling. The definitional frame is used for priming and orientation. The stereotype tells us how to do it, and the matrix consists now of the deep model and the modeling scenarios we are using, let's say, according to our stereotypes. That means in this case we have some kind of canonical definition frame. For instance, for entity relationship modeling is nothing else as you have a specific priming and orientation based on the ER grounding, based on specific adequacy and dependability based on the orientation. You have actors, that is a community of practice mainly consisting of the IS people and of business users additionally. And of course, in the IS community, you have the programmers. You have the language and the basis. In this case, you accept what the entity relationship modeling language provides you. And you might maybe use something else, maybe object role modeling, ORM, or UML. But in this case, again, you see it is almost the same for this kind of approach. I remember the typical assumptions we have already been making for entity relationship models. We have a grounding, we have a basis, we have common sense, we have deep adequacy, deep dependability, we have assumptions, and all this goes now, in most cases, back to our deep model that is accepted, and the rest is only our normal model that is somehow being developed. Okay, then in this case we have a little demarcation property. When is a model of no use for the community of practice? In this case, first of all, it doesn't fit to our community of practice. They do not have the culture. They do not accept our deep model. Or you have a non-fit of functions, especially coming also from the non-fit of the mode. Maybe you have an adequacy and dependability that is not at the right level of maturity. Maybe you are using an improper informative model, an improper cargo. You have maybe an improper or an inappropriate level of focus, scope, and abstraction. Maybe not the right elements are represented. Something is over-detailed and you are using some kind of manieristic modeling approach that is maybe too heavy. Object role modeling is typically also entity relationship modeling, but in a very manieristic setting. You have maybe a grounding on the foundation that is not the proper one. You might have also dynamics heterogeneity, or maybe incompatible function demands. And sometimes maybe you are taken in the complete wrong direction. Okay, that is now our lecture on deep models and matrices which somehow guide our modeling of normal models that are nothing else as add-ons, of course composed in a very specific form of deep models, but both models now can form a proper model that we can handle according to the functions this model has in some utilization scenarios. The next lecture will be now come to conceptualization and conceptual models. We will consider the notion of conceptual model, what is the addition to the notion of model if it becomes a conceptual model. We have to consider the concepts and conceptions, conceptualizations. We handle also that notion and terms are a little bit different from codified concepts. And we can also give some kind of demarcation. That means, since most models are somehow conceptual ones, or many models are conceptual ones, then we should now show what is the difference, the specifics, the advantages, and the disadvantage of a conceptual model compared to other kinds of models. Models are thus enhanced, they are nice, you have somehow to wake up with our model, and the notion of concept is maybe to be considered in a very specific form. This is nothing else as waking up our guy with showing a fish, and then we might have a conceptualization in the setting we see.